Josh Penn. I'm a senior partner, and I run at Duff & Phelps, and I run the restaurant, hospitality, food and beverage, investment banking business. And Duff & Phelps is one of the leading middle market investment banking firms, providing corporate finance, capital raising, M&A advisory, and valuation services to about 10,000 companies annually. And one of the other areas that we have that we're very active in beyond the hospitality space is the technology space. And we have a very active boutique firm that we acquired a few years back called PageMo Partners. It's one of the most active advisors to mid-market emerging software businesses, many of whom service the hospitality space. I'm here to introduce the last panel of the day, which is how cell phones have changed the dining scene. Whether full service, fast casual, cell phones have changed the way customers dine and how businesses operate. Camera phones and social media influence restaurants to be Instagrammable and Facebook friendly. Mobile payments are fast and easy. And the cell phone and mobile technology has and will continue to change the restaurant industry. And there's obviously, you guys are well aware of that, but two stats that I found that I thought were pretty interesting. Sales on mobile order ahead apps are expected to reach $38 billion by 2020. And in-store mobile payments will reach over $500 billion by 2020. So clearly, those technological advancements are having a real impact on the sector and are probably one of the top three most impactful forces impacting the hospitality sector today. They're also one of the most important as we are valuing businesses and raising capital for businesses. It is one of the components of each business that most impacts the valuation that companies are able to achieve. So with that, I'll introduce Fred LeFranc, the founder of Results Through Strategy.
Thank you very much. All right, I know everyone's thirsty in the room, and you've been sitting here listening to a lot of data. Most of you aren't used to sitting this long, so I appreciate your patience. We have an interesting panel today here. We have a couple of people who work with some operations companies, and then a couple of vendors that have some unique technology. I'm going to let the panel introduce themselves very briefly, and then we'll get started in terms of the content. And if someone has questions, even throw up the thing, raise your hand. It's a little bit hard to see. It's a little bit blondy up here. I sort of feel like Oprah Winfrey. But if you have a question, stand up, raise your hand, we'll try and get your question heard. So I want to be a little bit interactive here. So go ahead.
Absolutely. Thanks very much, Fred. My name is Ali Portman. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Sense360. And what we do is we help restaurants measure and optimize absolutely everything they do, every tactic, every strategy, every one of their competitors. We help them measure and then ultimately optimize off of that data.
Great. Thank you. Ray?
Hi, my name is Ray. I'm head of technology at Dig In. And we are a restaurant group in Boston and New York. We have 15 locations in New York, soon to be 3 in Boston, so very exciting. And I oversee back-end operational, the tech stack, and software implementation, as well as all digital interfaces that we own, so most notably the website and the mobile app.
Great.
Michael. Michael Hagan, I'm co-founder and chief strategy officer at Level Up. Hopefully, well, being in New York, hopefully we have a few Level Up users in the crowd.
Are there any users in the crowd? Raise your hands.
Any Level Up users? Okay. A few lighter than I'd like to see, but you can manage through. Yeah, we're based in Boston. We're growing like crazy. We're doing some really cool things. Excited to share what we do. We work with both Dig In and By Chloe. Great
question. I'm Samantha Wasser. I'm the creative director and co-founder of By Chloe. We have about 7 locations, 2 in Boston, 5 in New York. And the Sosto, which is an Italian quick service restaurant, which just opened on Mott and Kenmore.
That's great. So it was at the very beginning of the conference, Andrew pointed out that today is the anniversary of the introduction of the iPhone. And this was 10 years ago, and it really revolutionized everything. There was a very famous interview by Forbes magazine with the CEO of Garmin, who at one point dominated the sort of the map devices for people to run around. How many of you had Garmin devices? Few, right? They're really expensive to sort of stick in your windshield and some stolen. But they were asked, the CEO was asked, are you concerned about phones? He goes, oh no, phones aren't going to do anything to our business. you know, 3 years later, their stock was, you know, worth 100, a little bit of a fuss, because their application became an app. And this device, is, you know, as Warren just said, has changed everything. This is really the fourth screen that the society has now used. The first one was movie theaters. Years ago, before any of us were born here, maybe a few of you would recall, everyone would flock to a movie theater every single week to get the news and to watch movies. That's where they got their news and entertainment. The movie theaters, that was the golden age of cinema. From there, then television came in and disrupted movies, and now people sat at home. And I think the first TV screen had a screen about that big, you know, in black and white. You know, some of you who are boomers remember the remote controls in those days were you. You were the kid, your parents had changed the channel, they're gonna change the channel. And then, of course, color television came in there. That became the golden age of television. And then the PC came about, led a little bit through, you know, IBM's introduction along with Apple, and that became the third screen. And we started getting news and entertainment and other things to create on that third screen device. And now this is the fourth screen. I don't know if this is going to be the last one. I have a vision that 50 years from now we're going to have corneal implants that give us a TV screen in our eyeball. And I don't think that's too weird. I'm a science fiction fan. And I think that the time of us having stuff in, you know, sort of insert in our bodies, we're not too far away from that. We already have that anyway, right? You got pacemakers, you've got medical devices of all sorts that are going in there. So we live in a disruptive world, and we're also at the very beginning point, at the first talk, the tip of the iceberg of the Internet of Things. How many of you know what the Internet of Things is? Okay, not a lot, a few. Anyone have a Nest thermostat at home? Drop cam, things like that, a smart refrigerator? That's the Internet of Things. Now, in the restaurants, the Internet of Things is just starting out, and this is an exploding area. And a lot of these are connected to smartphones. Now, it's interesting that most people have about 100 apps installed on their phone, and maybe use about 10. But if, from a professional standpoint, that's going to begin to be changing. So I'm going to read a very quick list of some of the technologies that are linked to smartphones, just to give you a sense of how big this is going to be. I'm not naming the companies that are using it. We have a couple up here that can talk about it. And of course, our biggest challenge as operators is to balance high touch with high tech. I really think that's fascinating. Nowadays, you see a lot of, I travel 45 to 50% of the year. I'm in a lot of restaurants, I'm in a lot of hotel bars late at night, and nobody talks to anybody. You walk in the room silent, they're all looking at their damn screen. It's just fascinating. In fact, if you talk to one, they feel you're kind of a pervert. what's going on here? All right, so here's some of the things that are going on. Waitlist management reservations, tabletop media, smart kitchens, guest Wi-Fi, sensors, cloud POS that is device agnostic, energy efficiency, phone charging, staffing, digital display, training, marketing and CRM, white label delivery software, financial management, websites, apps, and of course Instagram, which is really another way of saying food porn. And that's one of the things that's just fascinating. How in God's name can we keep up with all this technology? Now, what we're going to talk about today is not to answer that specific question, but really start to get a sense of how do these companies either service their restaurant clients using technology in a very specific way, or how do the operators present in the room are able to use technology as part of the strategy. One of the things that restaurants now, almost as a price of entry, is they need to be tech-enabled. It can no longer be sort of, you know, Luddites, you know, pushing technology away. I'm not suggesting everyone has to adopt it, but because this new generation coming out, they're digital natives. Most of us in this audience are digital pioneers. We're the ones that sort of, the boomers are the ones who had to learn it late in life. Gen Xers built the stuff, and then millennials were born using it. And you know that nowadays you give a two-year-old an iPad, they immediately open it up, get to their favorite app, they buy their father a car on eBay, and it's new. But I'm going to start with Samantha. So Samantha's a creative director, and of course you created the bike Chloe concept. And just tell me from your standpoint, as you were designing it, did you have technology or the thought of how guests interact with technology in your restaurant in mind when you were designing it?
Yeah, so specifically for our clientele, we knew Instagram and social media would be huge for us. So I think that what we're seeing now is how people are really considering that before they're looking at a concept. So whether that's from the branding and design of the restaurant, so will my food look better on a tile table or a wood table, is coming into play, and that was something that, you know, we definitely looked at, as well as how our food would look in the packaging. So all of our packaging is to go, but it's heavily branded, and each item is uniquely branded. So instead of having our logo across everything, each packaging has its own unique identity. So our burger packaging is different from our french fries, which is different than our cups. so that anyone, anytime that they come in, they can maybe get a unique experience and are encouraged to take a photo. So we definitely took it into account from our branding design and also how the food was being presented. So our salads are have all the ingredients layered on top, so it's really colorful and vibrant so that people want to take a picture versus tossing it in the back and then the photo not being so great.
Yeah, when I talked to Samantha, I was really impressed by that. How many of you consider Instagram when you're designing your dishes or picking your china, picking your tableware? A couple of hands. And that's fascinating. By the way, I learned a trick a while ago. For those of you, how many, by the way, take food pictures before you eat? You no longer say, okay, take pictures. One of the best things I learned is to take the picture upside down because the camera's actually closer to the food. You get a great angle that way. You can't, so try that next time you're trying to take some food porn shots. But it's fascinating to hear how that is now a consideration. I worked with a client in California, it's a millennial client, and his method of determining the quality of his product is food you can tweet, which is another kind. When I first started to go, God, I would never have thought of it from that standpoint. Now, Ray, you know, you're working with Dig, and I know you're in the technology space. What are you doing in terms of interfacing and guest engagement, Dig, in terms of the technology piece?
Sure, so I think kind of almost the reverse of what Samantha was saying is that nowadays, because so many people are on mobile and they use digital to consume their media, you see restaurants responding to those platforms by designing their stores, designing their food to really be consumable on those platforms. And then on the flip side, you also have to realize that now hospitality doesn't just exist in the offline space, right? So your brand, there's no such thing as an offline brand. And so when you're thinking about your guests, they're interfacing with your brand both in the store, but also through the content that you put out digitally. And so for us, one big priority has really been building out our mobile platform. And we just launched our newest version of the app this June. And it's a little bit of a departure from our past setup, where we were really built on the Level Up software kit, which is similar to how I think By Chloe exists today. And so we moved away from that. We still use Level Up for rewards and loyalty, but we really wanted to own the app portion of it, the design, own the data in terms of really understanding where our customers are in the flow through the app. So taking the same thinking that you would draw from, I guess, approaching your store design and applying that to your app, where you're thinking about how is the guest hospitality experience from when they open the app or when they receive a push notification to when they make the purchase. And so the mobile app has really become a powerful, I guess, opportunity for us, where we see it as a way to directly engage with our guest through this device in their pocket. And I don't know about you, but I think my mobile phone probably goes with me everywhere. And traditionally, you know, there's like the phone wallet keys check before you leave a place. And often I forget the wallet and the keys, and I just have my phone, which works out because I can pay for everything with my phone. I can call people to let me into my apartment. So at the end of the day, I would say my mobile phone ends up being the most important piece of the puzzle anyway.
Yeah, and Ray's saying something that statistically has been proven. It used to be that, you know, surveys always ask these goofy questions. And the number one question is, what would you hate to leave your home without? It was always a wallet. Now it's your phone. Because you're absolutely right. It works that way. And it's fascinating because if you think about the traditional guest journey in restaurants, and we spend a lot of time mapping guest journeys for clients, our starting point for the guest journey is social media. That's where the experience does begin. So Ray's absolutely right about that. And it's not over when they walk out. It is over when they go back and start posting on social media what their experience was like. And so that extended sort of cyber part of the digital experience that now people have for their guest journeys got to be taken into account. Now, Michael, you're sort of the thorn between two roses. They both sort of alluded to using your services. Why don't you talk a little bit about what Level Up's done? You've evolved from the time I first met you, sort of pivoted a little way. Tell us what you're doing in terms of helping them with guest engagement, for loyalty, and things like that in Level Up.
Sure. So I guess I'll comment on, you know, just something that has become, I think, fairly obvious. The expectation in the mind of consumers is that every company that they're going to spend any money with is a technology company. Period. Because if you're not, then a consumer's going to engage with your brand and say, these guys don't get it, especially the younger generations that grew up with this. So the expectation, the bar is much higher. Level Up, we have been around for almost 6 years now. We build a lot of tools for restaurants to grow their businesses through mobile. So everything is mobile first. We began in mobile payments. We were very early there, tying things to loyalty. So by Chloe and Digin are a few examples of some brands that use our tools. And we do everything from building a full stack mobile solution. We call that our agency business. We power 250 apps for brands, small and large, or small and very big. And we have also done, the panel earlier was talking about systems talking to each other. So we have a very open platform. We integrate with virtually all of the point of sale systems that exist. We also integrate with all of the ordering providers, so the order ahead providers that service the restaurant industry. And there are two trends that have led Level Up to evolve our business model that have become pretty clear in the past couple of years. The first is that as consumers, we are downloading fewer and fewer apps. The latest report on this was about 3 weeks ago, that 51% of Americans download less than one app per month. Millennials have a little bit higher than that, but generally speaking, across the board, zero apps downloaded per month. You can put yourself in whatever bucket you'd like, but that's a trend that's continued. People want more from fewer apps. So that's the first trend. The second trend that we've seen that has become powerful and caused us to make some significant investments in our business was that every time we would implement order ahead into an app for a restaurant brand, that all of a sudden we have mobile payments, so you see little like cubes all over New York City and cities all over the US. When we turn on order ahead and give a consumer the choice between standing in line or skipping that line entirely, they're gravitating towards the skipping the line entirely. And both by Chloe and Digin, she probably has fascinating stats that I hope she'll share on this.
She owns the data now, you're all day.
We're working on the integration right now of integrating our order ahead with Level Up so that we can do that, because we get emails all the time from people asking if they can get the rewards that they get through Level Up through our online ordering, because right now, since it's not integrated, there's no way for them to get the rewards unless we manually do it. So there's definitely a demand for that, and that's something that we're working on right now to bring up.
So your second trend is now the order ahead. And if you stop and think about it, the idea, for this, especially with the next generation, that you're going to stand in line behind another human being to talk to someone standing next to this big box that's going to take your order is ludicrous. You know, when you can just place the order in. Now, of course, Starbucks suffered that.
They had what we call shampoo problems. Their system was so good that they ran into issues of bottlenecks.
And what did you call it?
Champagne problems, problems you'd like to have.
God, no, good champagne problems.
So,
I like to have hair.
So this order ahead trend is very millennial. They don't want to talk to anybody. If you have kids, I don't have kids. I got one on the way in January, first one.
Congratulations.
Pray for me, please. But the order ahead trend, once we would put it in an app, it started to skyrocket. And you have lines out the door by Chloe. In fact, one of my investors is here and said, I love by Chloe, but I've only eaten there once because the lines are too long. So good for you, champagne problems. We're going to fix that with order ahead. Digin, on the other hand, had the same problem, lines out the door, 20-minute wait in your lunch hour, which is unacceptable. Being able to place your order, skip that line entirely, the food's ready in 15 minutes, you place it at 11:45 instead of noon, and you're in and you're out. We recognized this because when we launched in all these apps, it would take off. We began to take a look at all of our integrations, and we've essentially knitted all of the providers together into a single API. And so the Level Up network, beyond our agency business where we build apps, is this new piece of our business where we are powering aggregated order ahead for large mobile properties. And I'll give you an example of that, a few examples. So Chase, one of the largest banks in the world, they're launching an initiative called Chase Pay. And Chase Pay is going to compete with Apple Pay, Samsung Pay, and all the other pays. Except their key differentiator is that they're going to focus on rewards. So you'll be able, if you're a Chase customer, you'll be able to download Chase Pay. You'll be able to see 100,000 restaurants in the U.S. that have order ahead capability that we have integrated with all those partners, and we can service that in a universal single menu flow. And from inside of Chase Pay, you'll be able to place an order at dig in any of the other brands that have order ahead available and skip that line, but also pay with your Chase points. And as you know, if you're a Chase customer, you've got lots and lots of Chase points you can't use. So this is the macro trend that we are betting heavily on, is that consumers will expect your brand to be in apps that are already on their phone. And if you're a restaurant, you want to both hedge your bet, you want the marquee branded experience that Dig In has to offer, it's a beautiful app, it's gorgeous, but you also want to be accessible to the masses, not the 10% that are going to be brand loyalists. You want to be and have your tools accessible everywhere. So we are enabling that through our, what we're calling, this kind of code word broadcaster now. But we're going to be able to put Ray's menu inside of Chase Pay. We're working to put it in the order ahead button inside of Yelp. We're going to be putting it in Google, which is not yet live. But you can imagine being in Google Maps and looking for food, fast casual, and being able to see Ray's menu there, being able to place the order directly from Google without having to download her app individually, which is a trend that's on the downtick.
So this is the thing that's happened, this confluence of all these activities. And this aggregator model, which you're talking about, is an anathema to several operators. They don't want to have that situation. They don't want sort of the open table thing of all my competitors are next to me. Trying to get some unique branding. So the importance of differentiation, ultimately at the end of the day, is what happens in the four walls of the restaurant is going to make a critical difference. That has not gone away. But I want to get to Ellie, because he's sort of quiet when he's sitting in the background listening to me, because that's exactly what his company does. One of the reasons I asked Ellie to be here is because he's here to prove to you that privacy is dead, okay, and profitable to be able to do it. So Ellie, why don't you explain what you're doing this, because this is where it gets really creepy. In a good way. I wanted to share his story. So you start understanding the power was there and what it could open up for you as a potential operator depending on the size of your business.
I'd like to start by caveating that privacy is not dead and we are not killing it. The broader point, I think, is the phones that we carry around in our pockets do have some pretty sophisticated sensors built into them. So they're able to understand the location of where you are. They're able to understand the movement. They're able to understand all sorts of things about where you are, what you're doing, and what's happening around you. And what we do is we partner with apps who create a consent, a user opt-in experience where the user is getting value by opting in to share this data. So whether it be discounts, coupons, rewards, they're opting in to share this data. And then we get to take that anonymized data, aggregate it, and have a holistic, never-before-seen view of how consumers interact with businesses. And this becomes incredibly powerful because all of a sudden, really for the first time in human history, restaurants are able to operate and measure and optimize with the same level of precision that Amazon and some of the online retailers have been able to do for a very long time. And so just to give you a very quick example of what this means, traditionally, operators have had a tremendous amount of data about what happens inside their four walls, but they have a very hard time understanding what happens outside of those four walls. Those customers that are coming in, where are they coming from? Where else do they go? How often do they come in? How are they interacting with other competitors of theirs? All that data was basically blind, and so if they ran a promotion or an LTO, they really just knew if the sales numbers went up or not, and nothing else. And all of a sudden with this data, with this massive panel of data that we're collecting, we're able to help them understand exactly who came in for that promotion. We can help them understand if it was a new customer or an existing customer, if it was a heavy or a light guest. We can help them understand if they come back or not. All of a sudden, every time they run an LTO, every time they run a promotion, they can now measure it, understand the impact, and decide if they should run it again, change it, not run it. And so our goal is really to use this data that's coming from the smartphone to help basically brick and mortar businesses, restaurants, be able to operate with the same level of efficiency that Amazon is operating with.
So let me give you some insights. I spent a long time with Ellie when I first met him. So you have now how many, 2 million or more?
Yes, a little bit over 2 million consumers.
Okay, so 2 million consumers have given him permission to access their phone at all times. So he knows exactly what they're doing, when they're doing it, where they're doing it, okay? And so if he wants to know whether we talk about an LTO driving success into your business, he can also help you understand whether or not an LTO or your competitor is doing is driving success for their business. Limited time offer. So if you're doing a limited time offer, so keep in mind your phone knows where you're going, where you've been, all that, where you're going, where you've been. And of course, because there's so many sensors, how many of you have Apple Watches? okay, tracks your paces and all that kind of stuff, so it knows when you're moving, whether it's one step or in a car, whatever the case may be. The reason apps like Waze and Google Maps are so successful is you're constantly getting data points from all the users who have this, and that's what's telling them the traffic's only going 20 miles an hour. It's not because someone's saying, hey, traffic's 20 miles an hour. No, they're getting it from the actual use, and then what Ellie's company's doing is tracking all that data. So if you want to know who's coming specifically, this is like when Nielsen used to have people keep TV logs. You know, they'd always say, oh, I'm watching Masterpiece Theater. Bullshit. You know, you're watching Father Knows Best. But you can lie because you want to sound smart and intelligent. Now they know what you're watching. Okay? And it's the same thing here. No one can lie to this because the device isn't able to let them know that. So give us an example without even the name names. Give you a sort of an example of a large company that wants to sort of tap into what their competitors are doing to give them inside information.
Yeah, so we work with one of the top three burger chains, and the three burger chains are constantly fighting with each other over share. It's a market share war battle. And so every time one of them runs a test, every time one of them runs a new promotion in a few markets, every time when they test the delivery, this competitor was able to look at the data and say, actually, delivery is working for them. It's not cannibalizing sales. It's driving more incremental sales. The type of consumers who are going are more affluent. They're able to basically use this data to now keep track of their competitors, understand their tactics, understand what works, what doesn't, and most importantly, how those tactics are affecting them. Because a lot, because we are in a market share world, because the market is saturated, consumers have so many choices, at the end of the day, every single visit is being won by someone, but it's being lost by someone else. And so when a competitor runs something, you need to understand how it's doing and how it's performing for them, but you also need to know if the way they're winning that guest and that visit is by taking it from you, and we're helping them do that.
So if you think about, how many of you were early adopters with email marketing? Anybody started with email marketing earlier on? Okay, because I mean, email marketing disrupted newspaper advertising, right? That business went away. And then email marketing, quite honestly, sort of kind of a little long in the tooth. It's no longer sexy. They used to have open rates on direct mail where the redemption was maybe 1% or 2%. Instead of 100,000 pieces, you have 2,000 bags, you're jumping up and down for joy. You know, but think about all the 98,000 that were thrown in the trash, no one ever looked at it. The Sunday newspaper, you know, that thing of all the coupons. When email marketing came around, it opened rates of 40, 50, 60%. It was amazing. Now they're down to about 10 or 50%. Better than newspaper advertising, but not as effective as it used to be. So now you have all these engagement platforms with, you know, Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and so forth and so on. I mean, even if you get Facebook Messenger, especially here in New York City, Ely now is allowing you to place online ordering through Facebook Messenger. I just flew back from Europe to come back to talk to you at this conference, and when I booked on Air France, checked in on Air France, they asked me if I wanted my ticket sent to me through Facebook Messenger. So I said, sure. And sure enough, there was my ticket. I didn't have to go through my email or an app. It just went right to Facebook Messenger. So all these different points of contact to what Michael was saying, you know, is this, you know, and how do you keep track of all this stuff? And so Samantha, I know you designed the concept and you're maybe not responsible directly to do the day-to-day marketing, but how do you decide, how do you keep track of these multiple platforms, this three-dimensional chess game we're playing to get the customer that Ellie talked about at the expense of someone else? What are you doing about that?
Yeah, for us, we do a lot of email marketing. We utilize our social media platforms. We have a very small team. We are looking to build out, a lot more technology-based platforms for us so that we can, start utilizing more information to see what our customers like, what their habits are, so that we can start targeting them better. But for us right now, we do focus a lot on what's available to us and what's free, which is social media. So, we post a lot on our Instagram stories because that's, in the moment we had a Labor Day special where we ran a lobster roll in all of our markets, which is usually only available in Boston, and over a 3-day period we sold several hundred just by putting it on social media and sending out an e-blast, and that was over, Labor Day, which was an undesirable time for people to even be, in New York in our restaurants. So for us it was successful, and I think that, especially for smaller companies that maybe don't have a crazy budget, it's, really about being scrappy and using what is available to you, and social media is a huge platform for our restaurants, and we definitely try and utilize the stories to try and, give content that's, more than just like a photo, but we do interviews with our staffs and, things like that, just so that people feel more of a brand loyalty and a brand connection.
Well, Michael said earlier that people, millennials and maybe the millennials as well as the centennials are following them, don't talk to each other anymore. They just text. I mean, you know, it's the classic things. You know, you got a bunch of kids in the car, they're all texting each other because they want mom and dad to hear what they're saying. So they don't talk. It's amazing to me that they're calling this device a smartphone because millennials don't even use it as a phone. They don't even talk to anybody. It's always some sort of, you know, it's a texting device. I think at some point they might change the name. So, Michael, you're clearly on a world domination strategy through Level Up. And you're partnering with Chase, which is a good partner to have. You said you want to be against Google Pay. You're going to go up against Apple Pay as well, PayPal. All the large companies are really doing it. And, of course, I don't know how many people know, the top 30 retail chains in the country about 10 years ago formed an association to have their own payment vehicle. They originally named it ISIS. They changed their name since now it has a different name. So it's you know, that's one of those horrible things when something, you know, bad happens to the name you chose, like the old weight reduction chocolate used to be called AIDS, and that stopped as well. So how are you going to differentiate yourself? Because you have the same challenge that the operators have to differentiate yourself against these behemoths that are trying to play with you.
Yeah, so that's a great question. The Chase Pay product is you know, Chase's own property. And so we are a technology platform that they're using to power
your white label.
Right, the vast majority of that tool. But we're also working with Google, Apple, Yelp, Facebook, Foursquare, Alipay, Samsung Pay. So we are an open book. I forget who was saying this on the stage in the earlier panel, but we believe that, you know, a consumer, you really need to be where your consumers are, and you can't control that. So we've taken the approach of be everywhere. I don't care where someone wants to order by Chloe or Dig In, but if they order from Google or Yelp or the Dig In app or Facebook Places or Google Maps or one of the assistant properties that we're going to be powering for all these people, that's all going to ride through us and hit them, and I don't think they're going to care. They want the orders, and that's the future. That's the perspective that we have. So we positioned the company to be very open and really work with as many partners as possible.
Now, Ray, at Dig In, are you doing a lot of delivery?
We do a lot of delivery.
So this is that interesting thing that's happened. So if for any of you have a DVR or TiVo, you know, that was sort of time shifting, right? Instead of having to rush home to catch your show at 8 o'clock on Monday or whatever day it was, you just record and watch whatever you wanted. So that, you know, when I want to see it is what became the on-demand consumer for entertainment. Restaurants now seem to be sort of place shifting. I no longer want to go to you, I want you to come to where I'm at. And of course the beauty is that a family of four can order from four different places. Now I have issues with some of the food that shows up in the state it's in, that's a different story. But for you, how is this delivery, and so, are you doing your own delivery, third party delivery? Of course you're in New York, so Seamless sort of has a monopoly on everybody.
We do both.
You do both, okay, so your own as well as Seamless. And it's a large part, you know, to share unless you want to, but it's a large portion of your business. Have you seen it grow?
I think it's interesting because we use a mix of delivery through our own platforms as well as through third-party services. We've been piloting, I think Meatball Shop was saying that they use DoorDash, Caviar, Postmates, and you know, there are just so many different services out there now. We use a mix of both. We've seen growth on certain platforms. I think some drops on other platforms. And then our goal is really, you know, there's a balance. Michael was alluding to this where, you know, I think you have your own branded channels where you can deliver this marquee experience where you're really catering to your guests and making sure they get that sense of hospitality that you deliver in your restaurant. And then there are these other platforms where your food is offered as a product, but you really don't get that control over the brand or the experience. And so I think where we are right now is actually reevaluating our delivery strategy and thinking through how can we deliver the Dig-In experience no matter what. And you know, there are operational factors to that as well as I think marketing and front end online experience.
Right, and of course that's the big issue. You don't know who's delivering your food, you don't know what the dish is gonna be, and of course Samantha talked about packaging, right?
Yeah, well, we do the opposite. We don't do any delivery on our own, we only work with third party sites. Postmates and Caviar have been huge for us in Boston. DoorDash is really big there, so we use them just you know to take that weight off of our staff and you know less people to manage insurance and things like that is just huge for us to be able to use third party sites has been you know substantial for our business.
And are they, in both cases, are they app-enabled? Is there either a mobile website, or is it an app, or is it someone using a third-party website, or all of the above?
For us, we, like, you could get it through Postmates app or through the third-party app, but we also have order ahead, which is pickup through our website, but we have, like, links that will link out from our website to those third-party sites.
Okay, Ellie, I'm going to put you on the spot. All right, so you have two potential clients here. I don't think they afford you, but here they are. What could you do to help them figure out a strategy in terms of this delivery?
Well, delivery is a fascinating question. It's an incredibly fascinating question because when you use delivery, especially third-party delivery, you're essentially giving away somewhere between 20 and 30% of your revenue. And so you have to be really, really sure that when you are using a delivery service, that you are not cannibalizing in-store sales. That by being on DoorDash, you are not just giving away a visit that is now basically
and profit.
Yeah. So it's an incredibly expensive proposition. But if it's a new customer, if it's a new visit, if it's an order you wouldn't have had, if it's incremental, it's incredibly lucrative. And so that is the key question that every restaurant has to answer. Is third-party delivery cannibalizing in-store visits? And so we actually did a whole study on this where we looked at the 2 million consumers, and we looked to see how many of them had third-party delivery apps on their phones. And the first thing we noticed is that if someone had a third-party delivery app on their phone, they were actually less likely to visit a restaurant. So there was definitely a drop between people who had a delivery app and people who did not have a delivery app. But the more we looked into it, the more we realized that there wasn't really the correlation that we thought there was. And the reason there was a drop was because it was a very different type of consumer. It was a more affluent consumer who in general was going out less to QSRs and fast casuals. They were going more to casual dining, and they were going out more to upscale places, but they were just they were more centered in like San Francisco and New York and Los Angeles, and so that wasn't really a great correlation. So the next thing we did is we actually followed consumers over time, and we looked before they downloaded the third-party delivery app, and then looked to see how many visits they had. Then once they downloaded the app, we followed them again to see how many visits they had. And what was fascinating is there was actually no drop-off at all. And so leading us to believe that third-party delivery is incremental, that it's creating a new occasion, that it's not that you are thinking about whether you should go in to dine in or not, and then you're like, well, I'm not sure, but I'm just going to order in. That was good. So what we found was actually it's a completely different occasion, where it's like you're at your office, you don't have time to go out, you're going to order in, and it's just a completely different occasion type. The one caveat I will say is that, and you were talking about this before, is when you have a third-party delivery system, you are disaggregating yourself from the consumer. And so even though it may not lead to cannibalization in the short term, over the long term, you are losing that relationship with the consumer. And that new consumer is definitely less valuable than if you were able to just get them to come into your location. And so I think the right mix is probably to use a combination of third-party delivery, first-party delivery, and still make sure that your in-store experience is amazing, because otherwise you could end up over the long term impacting your business.
And Ellie's got some published reports on this. It's fascinating. And by the way, I know he insists the privacy is not dead, but he could have known that without following all his people. So they've opted in. This is not done without their permission. Gary, what's your question?
I'm just curious.
We don't. We do. You do use things
this way. By the way, I
work
from
home.
Awesome. It's like the easiest thing for me to get.
Yeah, please check out the app.
Yeah.
More profitable for
me.
Firm like Seamless account. So these are totally new customers,
And so we, in some cases, use those platforms as the acquisition funnel, and then are evaluating various third-party services as well, just to do the logistical piece.
And by the way, the phenomena of these delivery things has been enabled by the smartphone, and that's really what's done it. Corner Bakery, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Corner Bakery, 25% of their sales is third-party delivery, or their own delivery, but third outside catering and pickup orders. 25% of the sales. They're now building delivery kitchens in Los Angeles where you'll order, you think it's coming from that one down the street, but it's going to come from a delivery kitchen. And we just did a blog post on our website where Mendocino Farms, a very successful high premium chain of sandwiches in Los Angeles, is now going to start building delivery kitchens as well because their delivery business has just exploded in an incredible way. And it's an example of how smartphones have infiltrated our lives in ways we could not even imagine. Now, I've noticed many of you appear to be praying while we're talking up here, the typical iPhone prayer, which is to catch up on email. These are great things to do at conferences, to catch up on email. So we're battling this addiction everyone has to their smartphones. And now, how many of you are recovering smartphone-aholics? Quite a few of you. How many of you don't want to admit it? Okay. Anyway, that's the challenge. But I do want to give you an opportunity. I have a few minutes left. Does anyone have other questions that you want to? Go ahead and stand up, shout out your question.
We have a mic.
Okay, there's that. I see a white shirt in the head. There we go.
Just listening and seeing the mobile payments and in terms of polished casual and takeout and delivery, all of that is going to put a lot of pressure on a mainstream casual restaurant for time. Because if you have a 10-minute dining experience or a 50-minute or an hour dining experience, everyone's going to expect those dining experiences to roll back. And it seems very good on the prepay and the pay ahead, but when you're in a restaurant, I'm waiting desperately for someone to do a mobile pay that works. Because it's not quick. You don't. Now we're dealing with chips and things like that, which reversed the trend that was almost there. So yeah, it seems like the prepays and the pre-orders and the order ahead works, but when you're sitting in a traditional casual, family restaurant, that experience is
in casual dining. There's a couple things. First off, you have Ziosk and a la carte. They're both sort of electronic. I'll call them electronic tabletop media, where you can order food, download games, play music, and pay and walk. Okay, so those are available. They're not the prettiest things, to be honest with you. I think they've got improved a little clunky, but they're there. And some other POS companies are now, I know NCR is doing this for sure, they're enabling you to log on to the in-store Wi-Fi, find your check, and pay off your phone. It's not, again, it's a real simple thing to do, but I think what you're going to find, maybe Microsoft have a solution, is all coming about. But you're absolutely right, the casual dining. But I'll tell you one thing at the end of the day, casual dining is not dead. It's still gigantic. What casual dining is boring, okay? But there's plenty of restaurants that have reinvented this whole sense of theater. And I think New York, you guys have got some phenomenal restaurants here that really engage the consumer in phenomenal ways, the things Samantha talked about, the presentations, the service, the hospitality. And at the end of the day, that ultimate, that human experience is going to count. Technology cannot replace bad food and bad service. It can only enable and accelerate something you do really, really well and are committed to do. And I think that's the approach you have to take. Other questions out there? Got a microphone wandering on the middle? We've answered all your questions. You're spellbound by the content. All right. Well, I think time has passed, and it's time to. Do you have another question here?
I think about both of you. No disrespect to the tech guys. It's just my fault. I'm sitting next to Babs, so he's telling me what really works and doesn't. Though I'm almost thinking, like, if you do the math on using Seamless and a third-party delivery on the margin you just put out, I don't know how you make any money, but that's because I'm an accountant. I'm thinking that, and then I'm like, can I use my mobile, my Chase points to pay Seamless and DoorDash? But more about, like, to Samantha and to yourself, using the social media platforms like Twitter and Instagram to really integrate. I just want to hear more about how you're reaching your consumers or your guests or your followers, because you guys have kind of, like, cult-like followings.
Yeah, for us, we definitely like to continue communication with our, as we were saying, like after someone leaves the store, how do you, engage with them when they're posting and things like that. So, I make a point every day on my way to work or, every night I go on and I like every single photo that's posted in the restaurants. And thankfully we have a lot. lot, but you know, I try and comment as many as possible. Now if someone does an Instagram stories, it automatically tells you if they tag you in it, so I'll like send them, you know, a direct message saying like, thanks for coming in, and you know, we're seeing a lot of uptake in our following. Also if someone sends a photo to us on Instagram that, you know, or they post a photo that says, oh, my fries were soggy, I'll reach out right away and say, you know, please send us an email, like, we'd like to make it up to you. And, you know, we've seen that customers love that. So I think it's just utilizing those platforms to continue communications with our guests has been hugely successful. And, you know, we see people, I can, like, see the conversation in direct message, then go back in and then send me another photo to be like, we went back in today and it's so awesome. And also one point you were saying about, you know, when you use third-party services, how do you, you know, create that brand loyalty? And one thing we've been discussing is, because Postmates is so big, is, you know, including maybe a cookie with, like, a note in some of the bags that go out to Postmates, so that people, when they get it, they're like, oh, you know, I still want to go into the store, or, you know, they're thinking of me as the special customer. So that's something that we're trying to implement, is ways that we can really make the experience unique to customers, even if they are getting it through a third-party site.
Well, the thing to keep in mind, too, Gary, and for everybody else, is that if you're not watching your social media scores, there's like 12 sites that have some sort of scoring. Everyone talks about Yelp and TripAdvisor, more, you know, Facebook, so far and so on. Harvard did a study that one star is worth 5 to 9 points in sales. One star. And ironically, even though I consult with restaurant groups for a living, when I travel, I will look at Yelp. And that extra star will make a difference of whether I consider it or not. Now, you have to keep in mind who's making that evaluation. You know, if it's your friends and family, loved ones recommending the restaurant, one thing. If it's someone has no taste, so, you know, just because a lot of people like Cracker Barrel are going to go there, they were 4-star. But keep that in mind. Those star ratings are worth a lot of money to you because it does influence people. The days of the official restaurant critic and movie critic are long gone. It's now friends and family and social media.
And that's, we get reports every day with all the user report, any user reports across all platforms, Yelp and all, from Fango reports, and I email every morning any posts that come up that day so that we can monitor it and reach out to those customers if they've had a bad experience as soon as possible.
Yeah, and Fango is an example. I know Fango's in the audience. They tie their open table accounts with their system, so you really understand what people are buying, who they are. They're a little bit creepy too. I remember I went to a restaurant in Houston, they go, so you're gonna have the same bottle of wine you had last time? I forgot. And then I was like, how did you, you went to me last time, and I really told you use Venga. And so you've gotta be careful how you use this inside information. I only give classes later on, the art of self. Work out that way. But thank you all very much. Thank you for joining me. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, everyone.